Hi and welcome to The Wedding Experts, where today we're talking gift lists and wedding reception themes. I'm Andrea Ventress, Deputy Editor of Wedding Magazine, and together with my team of experts, we'll give you all the advice you need to know. Coming up on today's show, we meet a bride-to-be who's not sure what's polite to ask for when it comes to her gift list. We'll set her straight to the do's and don'ts. Plus, themes and decor. What's in and what is so last year when it comes to your wedding reception? All will be revealed. Joining me in the studio is bride-to-be Beth Adams. Hi, Beth.
Hi there.
Welcome to The Wedding Experts.
Thank you.
Now, I understand you've got all your wedding planned. It's just your gift list. What seems to be the problem?
Well, the problem is, I'm sure the same for a lot of couples. My partner and I have been together for a while, we've lived together for a while, and we've got everything we need for our home, everything you'd need for a traditional sort of gift list. What we do really need a hand with is our honeymoon, but I'm not sure what the etiquette is in asking people to basically contribute towards it, so that's what I really need some advice on.
Okay, well, we've actually spoken to a really good wedding planner, Mark Niemerko, and he's the best person to ask for any wedding day dilemmas. Let's see what he had to say.
I'm Mark Niemerko from Wedding Planners Niemerko, based in central London. We offer a very high-end service for a very discerning bride and groom looking for that little bit of something extra special for that wedding day. Well, as a wedding planner, we aim to go that little bit extra and that little bit further for our brides. So, obviously, as an event organiser and a wedding planner, we find the venue, we source the catering, the stationery, so the invitations. But we also offer the styling advice and help that they may need for attire, so from finding the most perfect dress for her that she's been dreaming of since she was 8 years old, to also sourcing good hair and makeup, stylists, and so forth. I really do recommend clients should have a gift list, simply because otherwise they'll end up with gifts they might not necessarily want, and everyone will buy you a gift. You can go to various different shops for your gift list, from the most well-known, such as John Lewis, and other well-known department stores as Selfridges, House of Fraser. You also have more specialised and probably more exclusive, such as Harrods in Knightsbridge. You also have Thomas Good in Mayfair, which is an amazing cutlery and crockery specialist who can make you a whole bespoke set, which are amazing. And then you also have the Wedding Shop on Fulham Road, and they also run a concession in Selfridges, who are hugely successful. So nationally, there's quite a range of well-known department stores and so forth that offer a gift list. You have obviously Debenhams and John Lewis, who are possibly the most popular. House of Fraser recently launched one at the end of last year. And then you also have the most popular gift list in the UK, which is Argos, surprisingly. A good majority of my clients have perhaps been living together for, say, 3, 4, 5, or even 10 years already, and they've got a lot of items and a lot of homeware already catered for. But you always need a nice cutlery set or a nice crockery set that also has a bit more sentimental value as well, and meaning. So it's always nice to associate those items in the future to your wedding day. And also, couples may have lived in a smaller flat and now going to buy a bigger house post the wedding, so we'll need more to fill the space. So there's all sorts of different reasons that really couples that may have been together for a long time should have a gift list. So when it comes to my clients deciding on what gift list they would like, after I've already kind of discussed with them what they need and where they shop anyway, and what kind of requirements they like, and then I would maybe list two or three that best suit them and best suit their style and what they're looking for really. So when it comes to looking, first of all, go to websites. Look at how easy it is for your guests as well from that point of view. With such international guests and so forth, you want to make it easy for your guests to purchase gifts. So perhaps start looking around and on the websites before visiting shops. Go only to one gift list shop. Don't go shopping around for three or two, it's just too much. So only go to one shop that you finally settled on. You should already know a bit about that shop anyway, so you've probably been shopping there previously and stuff. So pick that shop, arrange an appointment, and start selecting your items. My top three tips for your wedding gift list are, at number three, have one. It's quite essential to have a gift list for your guests, as they will be wanting to purchase a gift for you, so you may as well have something that you've always wanted. At number two, by all means, ask for a cash alternative, if it's culturally acceptable. For example, I've previously worked with Asian weddings where we have carefully worded the information card. And at number one, my top tip for your gift list is offer varying budgets for different guests. Some people may be able to afford a huge amount and a huge gift for you, but others won't necessarily be able to have that in our budget.
Lots of great ideas there. The lovely Mark has joined us in the studio. Hello, Mark.
Hi, Andrea.
We're also joined by style editor of Wedding Magazine, Victoria Sullivan.
Hello.
Now, Mark, in your line of work, etiquette must play a big part. How often have you seen this kind of dilemma that Beth's having?
We've had this quite a few times where people have asked for a honeymoon gift list. I think it's quite a good alternative when people like yourself have been living together for several years and have accumulated all the household items they could ever ask for. So it's a perfect alternative, really.
So it's not considered bad manners in this day and age?
Not really, particularly with the current economical climate that we're in. I think people are understanding and appreciative of that.
Is there a good way to phrase this on the invites?
Yeah, absolutely. With your information card that accompanies your invitations, you should just put maybe a little one sentence saying it's great pleasure to have you attending our wedding, particularly if you've got international guests travelling and spending money and so forth on hotels and whatnot. So it might just be polite to put some simple wording saying, it's a great pleasure to have you at our wedding, that's a gift enough for us. However, for the people that really want to contribute to some form of gift to us, we've set up a gift list at XXX.
Fantastic. So, Vicky, obviously in your line of work, you're writing a lot of features on gift lists. Honeymoons is a good alternative to the traditional gift lists.
Absolutely.
Are there any other good alternatives?
There's loads of opportunities out there for you, Beth, if you wanted to have honeymoons and something else even. You can create your own garden with the garden wedding company. You can have your gift list at Amazon, where you could have every single book you possibly desire. Otherwise, there's artwork, which you could get from an online retailer called iStorm. There's so much out there for you to choose from. It's just really up to you what you want.
But Mark, what happens if Beth's going to invite Great Aunt Ethel, who's outraged that she's asking for help towards her honeymoon? Would you suggest that she maybe sets up a small traditional gift list as well?
That can be helpful and can work sometimes. We've done that we haven't done it when we've done a honeymoon gift list, but when we've had particularly an Asian or Chinese wedding, it's traditional to actually ask for cash, which, particularly if your wedding's happening in the UK, is a bit of an etiquette faux pas of asking for money. So what we've done in those instances is set up a gift list. And again, going back to the wording of the information card for the gift list, we've put, as an alternative to cash gifts, we have set up a gift list at wherever that gift list may be. So that's, certainly that's a way for the traditional older generation of your guests.
Are there any sort of hot, trendy items now that you're seeing brides putting on their lists?
I think the hot trend is really not to have a traditional gift list, so to speak, as far as it being household objects. I think the trend is to sometimes have that option of going to John Lewis, but also having the option, like you're doing, for honeymoon, for gardens, for buying a bespoke piece of furniture. I think the trend is to have two gift lists so that you, if you do need household objects and you do want something different, you can get both.
What about charities? Are you able to give money to charities as a gift list?
Yeah, absolutely. Charities work perfectly. There may be something that's really personal to you. So, of course, definitely, that's a really good option. I think going back to what Vicky was saying as well, variety is just key, and there's all sorts. There's also vintage wine lists, which are always quite good.
Oh, yeah. You have to create your own wine cellar.
Absolutely.
I mean, there's not a better present.
What could be
than
better?
So if you're a guest, how much would you expect to pay?
It really, really depends from person to person. And going back again to offering variety, so even if you are just doing one gift list, offer, you know, from really, really extravagant gifts like, I don't know, a plasma TV screen to a ladle. You know, offer all sorts of variety. I know that on times when I've been a guest to friends' weddings, I've suddenly logged in very at the last minute, like a week or two before the weddings, and there are actually just like towels and spoons and things like that. And actually, at the end of the day, that bride wanted that and wanted those gifts. So they're always appreciated, so yeah.
So Beth, have we given you any good ideas here? Are you going to stick with the honeymoon, or are you going to go with something more traditional as well?
Well, no, I'm definitely going to stick with the honeymoon. I feel much better about doing it now I know it's not a complete etiquette faux pas. But the idea of offering something alongside of it hadn't occurred to me, so that's a really good idea. I can look into that too. Maybe the vintage wine cellar is a very good idea.
Definitely.
That was a great idea. Thanks so much, Mark, Victoria, and thank you so much for being here, Beth. Still to come on The Wedding Experts, we're talking wedding reception themes. Join us after the break. Welcome back to the show. Now, I'm joined in the studio today by a very special guest, Wedding Magazine's very own Rebecca Wood.
Hello.
Hello, Rebecca. Now, you got engaged how many months ago now?
I got engaged in January and my wedding is in May.
Well done!
Yes! Why wait?
I know, it's very exciting. So, yeah. So you've got 5 months.
Yes.
What have you planned so far?
I've got my reception. I know I'm going to go and have it at the rather fabulous Blenheim Palace, which was totally out of my budget, but walked through the doors and fell in love, which is totally me. I just, you know, you just know that, you have that wonderful feeling. So, yeah, Blenheim Palace. And my colour theme is ivory with sage, and my bridesmaids are wearing controversially black. So it's going to be very mixy. I wanted everyone to feel very comfortable. I wanted to be very informal, but obviously, you know, a little bit of chic and shabazz and everything, making it feel fantastic as well. Because it's, you know, it's your big day, and
absolutely.
I just want to, yeah, go a bit crazy, really.
So have you got your dress, more importantly?
Yes, I have got my dress. I got that quite early on, actually. I mean, everyone says, oh, you know, when you get your dress, you'll just know, which I thought was rubbish. But it's true. It was the second dress I tried on, and I had a really set vision in my mind of what I wanted, which I tried on and looked awful in. Came out in my second dress, and it's a, well, I shouldn't say too much, but it's a halter neck with a full skirt, organza silk, and it's beautiful, and I just can't wait to wear it. I'm really excited.
Did you go shopping with your mum?
Yes, I went shopping with my mum and my aunt, and it's actually a really special thing to do. I can't tell you what a wonderful day it was. We had champagne in the room, we were trying on the tiaras, and it was just fantastic. I wouldn't have changed a thing. It was perfect.
So you're going to wear a tiara?
I am going to wear a tiara, and on the request of my mother, I'm also going to wear a full-length veil.
Are you good?
Yes, excellent. I wasn't going to. I was thinking, oh my God, that's so not me. But actually, when I put it on, it made the dress, and I actually felt like a bride. The second I put it on, the dress was amazing, but putting on the veil was just sensational.
Just totally made
it. Absolutely.
So you're a very, we all know you're a very energetic, very bubbly person.
Yeah.
What's your groom like?
Well, he is a corporate lawyer. It couldn't be more different from me if we tried. I don't know, for some reason it works. You just kind of meet in the middle and it's good. I mean, yeah, I think he probably calms me down and I pick him up. So somewhere along the line it works out and it's the perfect harmony.
Oh, so you're both looking for the same kind of theme for your wedding?
Yeah, actually, we've actually totally shared the view of what we wanted. Mm. We knew that we didn't want it to be something too stuffy, too formal, but we wanted all of our friends and family to be there and everyone to have a good time, because at the end of the day, I think people get so wrapped up in the occasion, but actually it's just a really good party as well. Like,
absolutely.
Let's have some fun. And so that's the theme I wanted to kind of get as well, was just let's have some fun. You know, I want to have a free bar. I want there to be booze flowing, and I want everyone to have a great time. And, you know, you've got to have music, otherwise and no one's going to have any fun.
And that's the area that we can help with most, because you're a bit worried about this theme.
Yes,
the wedding.
I mean, working for Wedding Magazine, you'd think I'd know everything, and I know nothing. I've been calling on you guys because you've been so helpful, but it is actually, it's just an enormous thing to plan, and I plan events all the time, but I had no idea how much work actually went into doing your wedding. Mm. It's incredible, and the theming, and I had so many set ideas, and then suddenly I went to Blenheim and all my ideas changed because the venue didn't work in the way that I thought it was going to work. Mm. So, yeah, I think the music part for me has been really difficult, because obviously I've got my grandmother's going to be there, which is the reason why I didn't want to go abroad for my wedding. You know, my grandmother's 85. And I've got my brother's going and he's 18. I've got all my friends and they're all, you know, crazy media people like me. And Jonathan's friends, which are more serious lawyer types like him. So, God, how do you please everybody?
Exactly. So, I've actually got a really, really good expert for you today.
Great.
Paul Johnston, he's the owner of Function Junction.
Right.
It's an award-winning service where he finds the right brands for your right kind of event.
Oh.
So I think he's going to give you loads of good tips today. Welcome, Paul.
Hi, nice to be here.
Tell us a little bit more about Function Junction.
Well, Function Junction is primarily a music agency, and that's what we specialise in. And we try to get the right bands for that the person really wants, rather than trying to push bands on people. We try to sort of find out what they want. And I think the most important thing is what the bride and groom wants, primarily usually what the bride wants, followed by the groom, and work from that to make sure it's going to work with all the people at the wedding and fit in with the theme.
So obviously with Rebecca, she was talking about having her 85-year-old grandma and her 18-year-old brother. What kind of band would you suggest for Rebecca's wedding?
Well, I think the first thing, you could pick any band and then you can sort of build around it. So for instance, if you went for a swing jazz band, what we find is younger people, after a while, after three numbers, sort of go, well, aren't you going to do any ABBA? You know, and so that's...
I love a bit of ABBA.
And you like a bit of ABBA. So in that case, if we were just going to have a jazz band, then maybe have a jazz band and then mix it with a DJ at the end. Mm. So you get that bit at the end. So, you know, if you were going to have a pop band, like a 60s to 2000 band or a funk soul band, again, that covers from 60s to 2000, most people... Even someone of 85, I mean, if you go 50 years back, well, they would have been about 35 when the Beatles were coming out, so they would have known the Beatles and the Stones. And, you know, old people are quite hip these days, you know, they know these things, you know, so they'll be fine, you know. And maybe if you're going to have a 60s to 2000 band, after the wedding breakfast, before the band starts playing, really, a band doesn't really want to start playing for at least an hour after the wedding breakfast. You have a bit of chill-out swing jazz at that point, and they can enjoy that. And then you have your 60s to 2000 band. They know the Beatles and the Kinks or James Brown or Diana Ross. They know all that stuff, so they'll be fine. Don't worry about it. But whatever you do, don't try to pick a band. Yes, try to get a band that works with the age group. And as I say, if you're going to go for a 60s to 2000 band, that's fine. But, you know, don't worry too much about... Try to get what you want and then work it into the age group rather than the other way around. Otherwise, you'll be very disappointed sitting there, maybe seeing a band that you really didn't want and you thought would work. I think that's the wrong way to do it.
It's your day, absolutely. Yeah. So how long should a band play for when you're booking them?
Well, it depends on the type of bands. Normally, pop rock and soul funk bands play for about 2 hours, and that's because they're quite high energy. And after about 2 hours, they flap. You know, so that's about right. You can split that into three 40-minute sets. So, for instance, say if the band's starting at 8:30, you could do something like 8:30 through to about 9:15, which is a great break for the buffet at that point. So you have the buffet about 9:15 to 9:45, another set through 9:45 through to about 10:30, and then another break through to 11:05, another set through, another 40-minute set through to, say, 11:45, and then an encore, and that brings you to midnight. So if you've got a midnight finish, that works really well, 3:40 minutes.
I've got my venue's very strict on the time that everyone's got to be out.
Yes.
But I mean, it's difficult to know, like, when do you actually start setting up the band? Because obviously there's going to be the speeches, and then for my flow, it's going to be the speeches, and then I want everyone to then start drinking and dancing. Mm. So how long does it take for them to set up, and how long do you need to kind of de-rig at the end of a night?
I think, first of all, the de-rig time, I wouldn't worry about too much. A band can usually de-rig in within about 20, 25 minutes. Bands want to get out.
Yeah.
They want to go home. You know, people sort of say, the band are going to have to stop at this time. And it's like, the band want to go. Don't worry about that. You know? So don't worry about the de-rig. As far as set-up times, usually between... somewhere between 45 minutes and an hour and a half. Obviously, if you're eating in the same room,
which
you are, then it really depends on timing. It depends what time you're going in to eat, for instance. Do you know that yet?
My wedding is at 1:30.
At Blenheim.
So it's in the Marlborough room, which is a little separate room.
Here's the way you calculate it. Half an hour for the service, 1:30 to 2. Yeah. An hour and a half for the drinks reception, 2 to 3:30. Quarter of an hour to half an hour to sit down, 4. 2 hours to eat, speeches and everything else. So then you've got 6. Your wedding's in May, so it's going to be a summer's day. No one's going to want to dance at about 8:30 anyway. People just want to sort of stroll around.
Okay.
So you're going to have plenty enough time there for a band to set up. So I wouldn't worry about that at all.
And do you think it matters that you're setting up when people are you know, finishing or just sitting around?
Well, usually people sort of wander around in somewhere like Blenheim Palace and all the beautiful gardens and everything. Yeah. It's going to be a lovely summer's day, of course.
Yeah.
And so I wouldn't worry about that. And bands don't tend to do large sound checks. It's not like hiring, you know, the Killers or something like that, where you know, there's going to be great, you know, roadies and everyone's, you know, they're usually very compact. They play week in, week out. They know where their amplifier levels are set. They know everything. It's just a quick tweak. You know, literally make sure the mic works. There's not going to be any one, two, mind your backs. You know, it's not like that. They do weddings, you know, professional bands that we represent do weddings, you know, weekly, you know, usually probably 30, 40 a year. So, yeah, I can say the bands from Function Junction are going to be fine. And I'm sure for most. Yes. No, I think most bands that are doing this on a weekly basis would be as well.
Thanks so much, Paul, for that great advice. Rebecca, I hope we've helped.
You've been wonderful, thank you.
Excellent. That's all we've got time for on today's show. Next time, sadly, is the last in the current series of The Wedding Experts. But the good news is that we've got a potpourri of everything you could need to plan your big day. As we round up your dilemmas on cakes, flowers, honeymoons, grooms, you don't want to miss it. But now we've got a bit of a treat. Paul's brought in the fabulous feedback band and they're going to play us out.